This video is a joint production between TrueTechTools.com and HVACRSchool.com. TrueTech Tools, quality tools, essential support. TrueTechTools.com. Hi, I'm Brian with the HVAC School Podcast and HVACRSchool.com. I'm making this video today in conjunction with TrueTechTools.com. And what we're going to be talking about is the 510i handheld wireless manometer. So the first thing that you'll notice about this is it's extremely small. It fits right in the hand very nicely. It's got a nice magnet, but it doesn't have a readout because it connects to your smart device, your smartphone, or your iPad, or whatever the case may be, using Bluetooth. And what's nice about this is it gives you the ability to do all the normal things that you do with a manometer, read gas pressure, test pressure switches, read static pressure. But in addition to that, you can actually use this to read airflow. And it has a lot of pretty smart software in the app that allows you to do this more easily than traditionally would be the case. And so today we're going to be using a pitot tube. This is a pitot tube. This is not a static pressure tip. Static pressure tip is not open on the end. If you can see here, we have an opening at the end of this pitot tube, and a static pressure tip doesn't have the L shape. It only has just the end.
A static pressure probe looks like this. So this is a static pressure probe. This is a pitot tube. The first thing you'll notice is that the connection points are different. The connection points on a pitot tube, there's two different points. On a static pressure probe, there's only one. A static pressure probe has a pointy end with no opening. It has the holes on the side, but it has a pointy end with no opening. A pitot tube has an open end. It also has the static pressure ports. So in a pitot tube, there's actually two tubes in one. You have the total pressure port, which is the one on the end here, and that feeds to the end coming out here, and then you have the static pressure, which feeds into these little holes in the sides, and that comes out the L shape that's perpendicular to the main body of the pitot tube. So it's important that you don't confuse a pitot tube with a static pressure probe. Some people get confused with that, and it's obvious why. They do look somewhat similar, but they're for totally different purposes. Now, you can use a pitot tube to measure static pressure. You cannot use a static pressure probe to measure total pressure or velocity pressure. The way a pitot tube works is actually quite simple. There's three forces at play here. You have total pressure, which is the force of the air coming in the probe. So if I were to put this into a duct system, and let's say I had air coming this way, blowing this direction in a supply duct, say, and I wanted to measure that airstream, I would place this tip in opposition to the airflow, and this tip would read the total pressure. So the static pressure, which is like the pressure inside of a balloon, the pressure that's forcing on all sides of the duct. And then it would also measure the velocity pressure, which is the pressure of the air coming into this tip being redirected. But then you have the static pressure, which is just being read on the side, and that comes out here. So by connecting the static pressure to the negative side on the manometer and connecting the total pressure to the positive side on the manometer, by reading the differential between those two, that's how you get your velocity pressure, just your velocity pressure. And velocity pressure, if you know the size of the duct, can be easily extrapolated, can be calculated into the feet per minute of velocity of the air. And then that can easily be calculated into the CFM of the air.
What's coming in this tip is going to be velocity plus static pressure. What's affecting these little holes on the sides are just going to be static pressure. So by subtracting the static pressure from the total pressure, we get the velocity pressure. Now the challenge in making these types of readings is that we're tempted to take this reading just at one point. You know, take this, insert it into the duct, take a reading. Well, velocity varies significantly based on where you take the reading in the duct. So if you take it on the sides or in the middle, it's going to significantly change and it will give you wildly different readings. So the only way to do this properly is what's called a duct traverse. And in a duct traverse, you have two options. Either you read at various points throughout the duct and you do the math, you average it all out, or you do what's called a timed average traverse. And that timed average means that you use software in most cases, and that's what we're going to do today. And it actually is measuring the entire time as you're pulling the pitot tube out of the duct or as you're moving it through the duct, and then it makes the calculation. Now,
the most important thing when you're doing a traverse is you have to actually lay out the duct properly. And on a rectangular duct, you take it on five different traverse points in most cases. And I'll share how to do that in a link. But what I'm going to be doing today is just a round duct. In my home, I actually have some spiral duct work. When I built the house, I always wanted to have spiral. So I have a couple sections of exposed spiral, which make it easy to demonstrate this, especially since I only have a 12-inch pitot tube, so I can't use a duct with a diameter of over 12 inches. Because when you do the traverse, you have to traverse the entire depth of that duct when you do the timed average traverse. So that's what we're going to do. There's a couple things I need to tell you specifically about the measurements that I'm taking today. I'm using a short pitot tube, which is easy to handle and easy to demonstrate on a video. But again, generally speaking, a 12-inch pitot tube is not a really practical tool. It's not something you're generally going to use a lot because pitot tubes are generally designed for higher velocity pressure. So if you have a commercial environment with high duct velocity, a pitot tube is a nice, accurate way of doing that. I'm reading this in a residential application in an 8-inch spiral duct, not generally what you would use a pitot tube for. You would generally probably choose an anemometer of some sort, hot wire thermal anemometer or a vein anemometer, induct vein anemometer to do this. But I'm demonstrating this tool, so I'm going to show you how to do the time traverse. Also, a lot of people will take a pitot tube and they'll insert it halfway into the duct, so right in the center of the duct. It'll take a single reading and they'll multiply it times 0.9. A lot of people swear by that way of doing it, and it's not a bad way of doing it if you have a really small duct, but it's still not quite as accurate because you're not getting the full range of the duct and taking into account any changes from the velocity of the sides to the center. So we're not going to do that. You can do that actually with the Testo Smart Probes app. It allows you to take a single point reading and it will give you a readout. But that's not really what we're here to demonstrate today. The other thing to mention is that the way that Dwyer recommends it is that you have 8.5 diameters past. So if you take the duct diameter, multiply that times 8.5 times, you measure that past any transitions or changes in the duct. I do have a reducing transition that's a little less than 68 inches, so it's an 8-inch duct times 8.5. So I'm not exactly what they're looking for, but I did keep it as far away from the transition as I could get, based on the way that it's laid out. So anyway, I'm just letting you kind of know the reasons why the readings that I'm going to take aren't going to be exactly within specification, but we'll still be able to accurately demonstrate how to use it. But before we do anything else, I want to first show you how to connect up the pitot tube to the manometer. So I've got some long hoses. It's good to have decent length hoses to work with. You don't want, you know, just a couple inches long. In this case, these are about, I would say, 5 feet long, right in that range. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to connect these. This is actually a 5/16 pitot tube, so I have different hose sizes. But it really doesn't matter. You obviously have to use the proper hose size for your pitot tube that you have, and then you have to adapt it down to the smaller hose size for the actual manometer. But the manometer comes with the smaller hose size. And in most cases, when you buy your pitot tube, that's usually going to come with a larger size. So anyway, this is a 5/16, and so I'm going to connect one to the back here. This is the total pressure, and then this is the static pressure here. So we have static pressure, total pressure. So now I just take the total pressure, this end here, and I connect this to the positive side, which is this port right here. It's imprinted here on the top. It's just a little hard to see in the video. So this is positive and this is negative. So total pressure is going to positive, like that. I was tempted to say like so, but we're not doing that here. This isn't a cooking show. And then the negative side here. So now we've got both of them connected. You can actually see here, they're really pretty snug. I mean, they're just press fit on, but they're really not going anywhere. I mean, I could hang this by the hoses and it would be okay. Not that I would do that, but if it falls off the duct with the magnet, it's okay if it hangs. And then it's connected here. Now it's time to do our traverse. So what I've done is I've set the unit onto high stage, but then I pulled the disconnect, which is why it says outdoor unit communication failure. But if you look, I think it'll show us what CFM we're producing. Yeah, so we're producing 1389 CFM. And then what I've done is I've gone through and shut off some of these vents in order to create as much velocity as possible where I'm going to actually be doing my readings in the spiral duct. So of course, when you shut off a vent, as you know, it's not going to be 100%, but it will increase the duct velocity.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and open the Testo Smart Probes app. And right now you can see that it's not on, so neither of these are on. But I'm going to go ahead and turn it on, and then it will search, and then it will find and connect. Okay, so you can see that we're at 0.04 inches of water column right now. But in order to make it even better, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to zero out the pressure sensor. All right, so now we're completely zeroed out. Now, before you do that, obviously, you want to make sure that you're in ambient. You want to make sure none of your hoses are kinked or anything. But I've already done that, so now we're at 0.00 inches of water column. And now we're going to switch the mode away from basic view, which just shows the basic readings of the sensor, to volume flow duct. And we need to go and we need to check the diameter here. So we configure measurement, go in and set the diameter, which I've already done. You can set rectangular or round. You can set multi-point, single, or timed average, and we're going to do timed average.
But down here, there's actually a pitot tube factor. And in this particular case, we're just going to leave it at 1. But you want to look at the specifications from your pitot tube manufacturer to see what the pitot tube factor is for the pitot tube that you're using. You can also go in and you can use standard air if you want, or you can set a different density calculation based on the temperature of the air. So let's say we want to set this at 74 degrees temperature, which is about right, and then we can actually set a different ambient pressure, which normally speaking would be 14.7 psi at sea level. But in this particular case, I actually have an app, a barometric pressure app, that actually shows me what the station pressure is right now where I am. So we're at 14.90 psi. So we're going to go back and change it to 14.9, and that will help give us just a slightly more accurate air density reading. So this is just giving us a more accurate air density reading based on the actual temperature of the air. Now, I pulled the disconnect on the condenser for this very reason, because if it was running in cool mode, the temperature of the air would be consistently changing as the system runs. So by pulling it, we know that the air in the supply duct is going to be the same temperature as the air in the return. So it's going to give us a little better air density reading. We're going to hit OK. As you can see here, we can also configure it for return or supply air. So now we're ready to make our reading. I'm going to change it back to the timed average. Hit OK. And now you see here we've got this play button here. So as soon as I want to start taking my timed average, I'm going to hit play. And then this little timer up here is going to start ticking down. Once I take my first timed average traverse, then I'm going to hit pause. Let's say I get it right at 10 seconds. Then I go and move to the other side and take my next timed average traverse. The idea is to, as much as possible, to make the traverses around the same time. It's not, you don't have to get it perfectly correct, because as you're pulling the pitot tube out of the duct, it's taking readings all along. But by getting the time similar, you're going to take a similar number of readings for each traverse that you take. So we're going to go ahead now and start a new one. It's going to say if you continue, the current measurement will be discarded. That's good. We want it to be discarded. Now we're ready to go ahead and take our measurement. Go ahead and shut it off.
So I've already gone ahead and made my holes, which in a round duct is significantly easier than doing a duct traverse on a rectangular duct, because we only have to make 2 holes. We just make 1 on each axis. So I'm going to go through here and then through here, average the 2, and see what we get.
All right, so I've got my 510i ready. I've got my pitot tube ready. I'm going to go ahead and just put the 510i in my pocket, although I could actually mount it with the magnet onto the duct if I wanted. Now, until I actually get this into the duct, any little change that I make with these tubes is going to tend to mess with my reading a little bit on my phone, and that's to be expected. So once I get in place, before I start making my reading, I'm just going to make sure that we're zeroed out before I start reading. And we are zeroed out. So now I'm going to take the pitot tube and I'm going to insert it into the duct, and I'm going to push it all the way in to the duct to the other side before I start my reading. Now, the most important thing is I'm going to be focusing I'm going to be focusing on the pitot tube when I pull it out. I'm not going to be focusing on the phone, because if I look at the phone, I'm not going to keep it straight, and I want to keep it as straight as possible. But before I even do that, I'm actually going to take it in here and kind of see where my highest reading is. So if I take this into generally the center of the duct right in here, and I'm going to kind of move it back and forth and watch the flow in feet per minute on the duct and see where I get my highest reading by just kind of moving it around a little bit. I'm actually getting a pretty consistent reading. Not really seeing any change. Oh, there we go. Right a little bit higher. So by kind of watching this, I can figure out what angle is the highest velocity on the actual readout. So it looks like this is about right. So now I'm going to go ahead and take my reading. And as you can see, we're reading, 0.02 inches in the velocity scale, which is very, very low. So it's not surprising that we're really on the low side of the resolution on this, even with the max duct velocity. Another thing to note is you really don't want to be in a hurry with this, because I have pretty long hoses here, and with the longer hoses, you just want to give it time. You want to work very slowly and just make sure that it has enough time to almost kind of like fill up the hoses with pressure. And that as you're reading, it at a very slow, measured pace. So I'm gonna go ahead now, and I'm ready for my traverse. I've got kind of my angle in mind of what I'm gonna use as I pull it out. And I'm gonna go ahead and hit play. I'm gonna slowly perform my traverse. And I'm just watching the actual pitot tube. I'm not watching my phone, because as much as possible, I want to keep that total pressure tip pointed into the airstream. Now I'm going to hit pause. So that was 23 seconds. I did that really slow, which is good. Now I'm going to go up here. Once again, I'm going to kind of take it into the center of the duct and just see what angle gets me my best. Yeah, and that looks good there. So I'm going to really hold that angle as I pull it out. So I'm going to hit play. I'm just going to take it out really, really slowly. Kind of like Bob Ross. Just a happy little pitot tube. Just a nice little pitot tube. Probably not funny. All right, 46, perfect. All right, so now looking at the phone. Now obviously I'm back at zero because it's out of the duct, which is a good sign. That means that the calibration is actually setting in pretty good. And so now I'm gonna hit stop. And that gives me my average. So my average is 770 feet per minute at 0.04 inches water column velocity pressure. So that is giving me the velocity pressure. 770 feet per minute, which is on the high range for residential, but the only reason it is because I shut down vents. And then 268 CFM is what I'm actually seeing in this duct. And measuring velocity pressure is a really useful reading to take. It tells you, especially when you're dealing with noise issues, it's a really good way to tell whether or not you're on the range of where noise would be a problem. If I saw this 770 feet per minute in a supply duct on a residential location, I would know that we're getting up there. We're getting to the point that we're going to start having some air noise. Now, once I open up these vents, that's not going to be the case. But just to see how, we know we're on the edge of the resolution of this gauge. But let's go ahead and do it one more time and just see if we read a similar reading. So I'm going to go ahead and, so we know we had 268 at 770 feet per minute. Let's go ahead and do it again one more time.
So that's it. That's how you use the Testo 510i to calculate velocity pressure and static pressure and CFM using a pitot tube. Again, I want to remind you that a pitot tube is not a static pressure tube. A pitot tube has an open end and it has the L-shape connection at the end. That's how you can tell it's a pitot tube. A static pressure tip does not have an open end and it only has the straight adapter. So don't confuse the two, otherwise it's not going to work at all. The other thing to know about the 510i, like I said, is you can use it for regular pressure readings in whatever pressure scale that you choose. And I didn't show you the setup of this, but it's fairly simple within the Testo app. You just go in and set up what pressure scale you'd like to read. But in general, as you know, we read water column. And all you need to know is because it is a differential manometer, if you're reading positive and only positive, you don't want to read differential, then you just connect to the positive side. If you're reading negative and you only want to read negative, like say, for example, if you want to read the static pressure on a return side duct and see what just the return side is, or if you want to find an airflow restriction across the return side, then you would just use the negative side. And the same is true if you were reading static pressure on just the supply side, you would do just the positive side. When you connect both, that's when it shows the differential between the two. Hopefully this was helpful. As always, you can go to truetechtools.com to find this particular product, as well as the pitot tubes and many other things. It's also where you can find the link for the duct traverse for rectangular ducts. Because laying out the duct traverse while on a round duct is fairly easy, on a rectangular duct, you have to make sure that you get the points in the right places. And so they have a great sheet there that shows you how to do that. And there's also some other videos that have been done in the past that do some specifics on how to do rectangular duct traverse. Thanks for watching. I've been Brian Orr with HVACRschool.com and the HVAC School Podcast, doing this video in conjunction with TrueTechTools.com.
Use the offer code GETSCHOOLED at TrueTechTools.com for a great deal on any of your tool purchases.